The New Tech Times, a video magazine for the electronic age. In this edition, counterfeit computers upset Apple's basket. Also, Mr. Rogers and CBS team up to make software. Later, visit with your family and relatives via satellite. Or if you can't, send a computerized poem. All this and more in this edition of the New Tech Times.
The New Tech Times is brought to you through a grant from Wausau Insurance Companies. Times change. Wausau works. And by the collective voice of the consumer electronics industry, CEG, the Consumer Electronics Group, Electronic Industries Association.
Hello, I'm Mort Krim. Welcome to this edition of the New Tech Times. This week, we report on both good and bad in the world of consumer electronics. We'll travel to CBS to explore the marketing of new software. Spend time in Atlanta, eavesdropping on a family teleconference. Head to Phoenix for some high-tech poetry. And visit Tim Anosko for his thoughts on the winter CES. We begin in California, where computer clones are keeping customs officials busy. Here's our report, produced by Gary Probst.
They're smuggled into this country aboard jets from the Orient. They're hidden within crates of cargo from Taiwan. They're brought across the border with clandestine methods equal to those used by the most sophisticated drug dealer. People who engage in illegal international intrigue are focusing on high tech. At the U.S. Customs Office in San Francisco, agents unpack boxes of computer contraband. It's no coincidence that some of these computers resemble an Apple II. They're from Taiwanese companies who are accused of stealing Apple's engineering design. They're illegal because they violate U.S. copyright law.
This particular importation, same stylized case, virtually identical to the Apple. Same interior with a power pack, keyboard, and a motherboard with six piratical ROMs.
But the copying goes beyond mere appearance. The ROM chips contain internal programs, information specific to the operation of an Apple computer. Some machines resemble an IBM or a calculator, but internally they're still in violation of Apple's copyright. The counterfeiters even go as far as to photocopy instruction manuals, replacing the word Apple with the name of their latest piratical product.
This is a page out of the Guanhua manual. You can see how they've substituted the word Apple with Golden 2. In this case, Steve Wozniak, the original founder and developer of the Apple computer, is writing an article on the Golden 2.
But computers and copied manuals are still smuggled in by the millions. They're believed to be a billion-dollar threat to the U.S. economy. The company with the most at stake is Apple. Names like banana, orange, and pineapple are used to hint that these machines are just as good as the model they copy. One of them is known as the Citron. That's French for lemon. And customs agents say that's appropriate.
As an example, when you push down a button or one of the keys on the keyboard, to print, as an example, an A and you let up on it, you get 10 A's after that. And, the ordinary person wouldn't know how to correct that. It would have to be repaired.
But repairs are also a problem. These clones carry no warranty. Many people try to have them fixed at Apple dealerships, but Apple won't touch them. The company's trying to stop the clones by helping customs. Apple employs copyright attorneys to fight in court and before the International Trade Commission. Former narcotics agents are hired as private detectives to track down the smugglers.
They would make initial contacts. They would make sample purchases. They would then arrange for large buys in the order of anywhere from 300 to 1,000 computers at a time. They would effectively enter into business relationships with these individuals.
They're watching you by their eyes. The job isn't easy. The smugglers have learned to bring the computers in one part at a time through numerous airports and harbors. Assemblers in the U.S. put the copyright-violating ROM chips into the cases when everything is passed customs. That's why Apple engineers developed a software package for attorneys and detectives to check out the copyrighted code on individual ROMs.
It will actually list out the percentage of the Apple programs contained within each read-only memory chip. And that's what it's doing. So we have a 99% copy, here's a 98% copy, and it'll just go ROM by ROM.
The crackdown on counterfeits is having an effect. Two alleged smugglers are being prosecuted in San Jose federal court. The U.S. attorney in San Francisco believes he can at least slow down the counterfeit trade.
There is a deterrent advantage which definitely comes from vigorous prosecution and conviction and strong sentence that wouldn't come if we just sat back and said, well, let the market be the determinant of success.
The authorities in Taiwan also claim to be tracking down computer pirates. The Taiwanese are concerned about their copycat image, and a spokesman for an economic development group says his country is clamping down on illegitimate companies to keep its U.S. markets open.
Everybody, everywhere, there's a bad guy and a good guy. I think the illegal computer manufacturers are only a handful. Though our government, as well as our people in my country, are very determined, stand ready to try to remove those bad apples from the basket.
But if the Taiwanese are unable to stop the illegal imports, the real Apple will crack down harder to protect itself and other high-tech firms.
It's like a parasite, or a sucker fish. You know, they're on that company and they're sucking the lifeblood. Now, for a company like Apple, which has some time to develop, it's become a very serious problem, but it's not a threatening problem. For a company that's just starting out, if they're faced with a counterfeiting problem, it could literally destroy the company.
It's just not fair. I don't think that any industry, especially this industry, is going to continue to grow unless companies feel that their innovative ideas are really protected by law and enforced by law against people who would simply copy them.
As customs officials, computer companies, and the Taiwanese continue to crack down on computer clones, consumers should be wary of any computers coming to this country from Taiwan. Mr. Liu points out the Taiwanese make computer components. They don't manufacture any brand name computers of their own. So if you see such a computer, don't buy it. CBS has been a brand name in television, radio, and records for a long time. Now they're trying to become a success in the software field. Here's a report produced by Tom Tomaszewski and Fred Dignazio.
There are important changes taking place in the jumble jungle of products businessmen call a market. You and I are still chopping our way through it. But gray granite buildings and corporations have replaced garage-bound hackers in the ranks of software authors. Their flashy packages are festooned with famous faces.
I think it's very important that if you do lend your name to a program, that you be intimately involved with it.
At the Winter CES in Las Vegas, CBS Software announced the first in a series of children's software packages, developed in connection with Public TV's Mr. Rogers. The software series will carry on the themes of Mr. Rogers' songs. This one is called Many Ways to Say I Love You. Rogers is aware of how powerful a pairing of a product and his name is viewed to be, and he is mindful of the responsibilities.
If you don't have a firm base as far as your own philosophy, then I think that what you do is just to loan your name so somebody can sell it. That's not what we're interested in.
There are some products that by their very nature are innovative. This, the Fred Rogers product flies in the face of people who have said, well, one of the things that we know the computer will never be able to do is deal with emotion and feelings. It's always going to be a cold, numbers-crunching kind of thing. I think Fred Rogers has proven with the product that that ain't so. So that's innovation, I think, in a very real sense.
The fact that he's willing to incorporate himself into our package, I think, shows his support for it and how well it was turned out. So I think we
Mr. Rogers' input is important in developing the software. His imprint is important so that it will sell. The art, text, and packaging experts had to work to entice you to open that program instead of the myriad of others on the shelves.
Now, this bio becomes like the second most important selling tool of the program.
My feeling is his first impact of the product should be to see the logo of, or the name of the product, many ways to say I love you, and see the image of Fred Rogers almost at one time as a whole event.
Now, if you want to erase the Mr. McFeely who's erroneously in the screen.
CBS hired software developers to write the program in liaison with members of Mr. Rogers' staff. Fred Rogers' contribution was the form and philosophy of that software.
We looked at it somewhat as an experiment because it was uncertain. I think the difference in the way Fred Rogers looked at the technology and the way other people look at it is that he didn't look at it as technology, he looked at it as a medium for delivering a message.
It's always been our hope that any form of technology can be used to bring people together and to help them to be in better communication with each other. You know, when over and over we say that what is mentionable is much more manageable. And if people can mention how they're feeling, they're going to be able to manage that feeling so much better than if they always had to keep it inside.
It's a choo-choo train.
Well, I've been on one before.
You were? Does it look like that?
Yeah. None of this is new to us as consumers. But it is a sign to software users that the business has left the hands of hobbyists for the slick arena of mass market sales.
If you have story ideas, suggestions, or comments about the New Tech Times, get in touch with us electronically. On CompuServe, use GoNTT. Through the source, log on with Public 125 Direct, or contact us directly through our 300 baud New Tech Times electronic bulletin board by dialing 608-263-2784. Here's what some of our viewers have said about the New Tech Times. Very much enjoy your PBS show, but wish you would make each segment longer. It is like watching the local TV news, where everything is compressed into as small amount of time as possible. We have longer attention spans than that. Ephraim Bonham, St. Louis, Missouri. Bruce Barr, a Kansas City area viewer, sent us this email about a recent Carol Larson commentary. I found the piece on telephone technology neither funny nor informative. I would expect a discussion of cellular technology and its impact on the information age, not this watered-down, bad Andy Rooney imitation. And finally, this comment via CompuServe. I have viewed your show for the first time and think it is a very good idea. But it seems that your show is trying to focus towards the non-user or computer illiterate. I guess my tip is that you get more technical in your reports and try to appeal to the computer user programmer. Eric Von Schlifka, Canton, Ohio.
Providing software for consumers in concert with Mr. Rogers was a stroke of marketing genius for the folks at CBS. Now, consumers, well aware of Mr. Rogers' reputation, will determine if the product meets or exceeds their expectations. For years, the telephone has been meeting the needs of consumers wanting to stay in touch with loved ones. But now, new technology promises even better communication with friends or relatives, at least during holiday periods. Here's our report, produced by Jim Carr.
One of America's favorite holiday traditions is getting together with family. So this past Christmas, John Sternberg and his family in Atlanta sat across the table from Jim Sternberg and his family from Sacramento. But brother Jim and his family were still in Sacramento.
We just got our black and white set last year. We've just been introduced to TV. They come out with this stuff.
I can't believe it. What life in the 80s, I guess.
The Sternbergs are visiting coast to coast and face to face via satellite. Commercial television pictures have been bouncing off satellites for more than 20 years, but the practice of conducting business meetings through satellite video conferencing has only recently become popular. And this may be the first time that a family reunion has been conducted through outer space. It's part of an experiment conducted by the Meeting Channel, a satellite video conference service headquartered in Atlanta. During the holidays, the Meeting Channel's satellite dish was not being used by businesses. So the folks at the Meeting Channel decided to test the family market.
It's been tremendous, and I think especially because we planned it around the holidays, and most of the airlines jacked their prices up in the holidays, and the delayed flights, lost luggage, all of that makes travel really uncomfortable. And this is a good way of being with your families without having to do the traveling.
There's grandma.
Can
they see us?
Yeah,
they're waving.
They can see
It had been a long time since the Sternberg family in Atlanta had seen Jim Sternberg in Sacramento. And this is the first time Jim's wife, Kathy, and his daughter, Pamela, have met Jim's family. Kathy helped to plan this video conference as a surprise for Jim.
Well, you know, this is one of those things that I'm not even going to think it's real until maybe tomorrow afternoon.
But after the initial surprise, Jim needed to learn about some of the technical aspects of video conferencing. Things like how to control the camera.
Hit CD in the middle.
CD?
A television camera is placed inconspicuously behind a smoked glass window above the viewing screen. Its movement can be controlled by pushing buttons on a panel at the conference table. The control panel can also be used to send pictures from a camera located in the ceiling. The pictures and the sound are electronically processed in the Meeting Channel's control room and can be beamed by satellite to any of the 13 Meeting Channel studios across the country. At the receiving end, the signal is reprocessed and projected onto a 5-foot television screen. The picture is fuzzy and jumpy because the Meeting Channel doesn't use the same transmission standards as commercial TV. The sound is telephone quality, and there is a slight delay while the signal travels into space and back at the speed of light. But these limitations seem small to the families that took advantage of holiday video conferencing.
We can live with the delay in exchange for getting this kind of a service, to get to be able to get together on the holidays.
Yeah, you guys have been terrific Santa Claus this Christmas. We love the stockings and all the gifts.
Holiday video conferencing for families has proven to be so popular that the Meeting Channel plans to do it again on other holidays. For some families, this could become a new tech tradition.
I don't know. What are we going to do next time? I don't know. We're going to have trouble topping this one. I don't know. Hopefully he'll be with us next year. We won't have to do this again.
You felt close, but yet, you know, you still sense the distance. So, you know, somewhat of a melancholy feeling.
You are
here.
We love you.
Happy New Year.
No. Happy New Year.
You love
Happy
New Year.
We love you.
Happy New Year.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Talking to your family via satellite may not be a bad idea if you can afford the $120 per hour cost. It's still not the same as seeing them in person, but can bring friends and relatives visually closer at times when communication means a lot. If you can't afford a video reunion, maybe sending a computer poem will do. Here's Tom Tomaszewski's report.
Poetry and sunsets hold a special place in the world of expressive emotions. Sunsets, at least, are there for us to enjoy. It's harder to place words in the proper poetic order. The perfect prepackaged expressions are even harder to find. Yet we spend millions each year on stuffed animals, balloons, personalized bumper stickers, and cards, searching for the perfect way to convey natural feelings. Enter a binary bard, a computer poet. It's a muse with mass market appeal.
Merry Christmas to Tag. This message to Tag now is real. It shows very well how I feel. She's gentle and kind. The way she's designed in Michigan she lives, I reveal.
It wasn't that I really needed a card because it's after Christmas and I was going to do a Christmas card. More the idea of punching the buttons, I think, to see what it would do. And when I typed in the name of the person, it was Tag, T-A-G, which are my wife's initials. And the computer responded with, I don't know if that's a male or female, help me out.
So it really doesn't matter what the computer understands. What matters is the result. And it was all simple questions, personal questions about a friend or relative. The computer can create a completely personalized message and poem.
With joy in your heart, best Christmas will start, and keep on till next year is through. From Paul, the computer poet.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
The poet is the product of Dwight Minkler's imagination. Now, it isn't Shakespeare, but it is passable verse. The poet itself is a Macintosh, programmed to lead you through the process of producing personalized greetings. You supply the name, the place, occasion, and two traits from a list of 80.
The computer, in addition, creates an additional choice. You might call a sixth item, which is entirely outside of the control of the person entering the basic information. And from all those combinations, the computer creates the personal poem. In fact, it gives you two poems to choose from.
First, we have to decide the sorts of traits and characteristics and messages that people would be most interested in seeing on the screen. And people, they want the traditional birthday, Merry Christmas, but we also have things in there like, you owe me money.
She's so bright and smart. That's quite a good start.
Dwight Minkler is working on giving a voice to the hundreds of computer poets springing up in card shops nationwide. Even without it, though, it seems the poet has given a poetic voice to young men like Mike Fowler.
With love to Madonna.
This is for a lady that I really like, and this really helps me to get my message across.
I love you. Just wanted to say it. There aren't many words to convey it. It's something I feel and know that it's real, though not easily to weigh it. From me.
Well, it may not be Shakespeare, but in the world of expressive emotion, the personal touch, even with the aid of a computer poet, is as proper as nature's perfect poetic order.
Computerized poems have joined other high-tech greetings now available to send friends and relatives. Audio cards, holograms, and now personalized poems can send your thoughts through the mail when a regular greeting just won't do. Columnist Tim Onosco didn't send us a greeting card this week, but he has put on video some of his thoughts about the Winter Consumer Electronics Show and a few of its product introductions. Tim?
What's your idea of a good time? Is it stomping around 20 acres of electronic exhibits with 101,000 other happy conventioners at the 1985 Winter CES? Let me tell you, these are the times that try men's souls. The soles of your feet, that is. Anyway, every year I look past the megabuck exhibits showing pricey new electronic gizmos for the little things that make CES something fun to be at. Then I quietly award imaginative companies for their foresight, or in some cases, their stupidity. This year, for the first time, the New Tech Times has allowed me to share this year's winners with you. I thought a little program called Chipwits deserved to be called the best new home computer software at the show. It's an incredibly entertaining activity for the Macintosh, Apple II, and Commodore 64 computers. With it, you create personalities for these on-screen cartoon robots, then watch them do their thing. I think Chipwits claims to be educational, but how can anything educational be so much fun? Runner-up in that division was Jet, a new flight simulator by programming genius Bruce Artwick. It was shown as a preview and will be ready later this year for the IBM PC, Mac, and other new 16-bit home machines. This one puts you in the seat of an F-16 equipped with deadly Sidewinder missiles and is disturbingly accurate in its simulation. Yikes! This year's Much Ado Over Nothing award went to Microsoft and something like 17 Japanese manufacturers who introduced MSX. A new standard for home computers with terrific ballyhoo. The problem is, MSX bombed in Japan, so why would anyone think it would take off here? Just what we need. As for the best toy of the show, that went to a German company, Fischer Technik, for a computer construction set that builds robotic and mechatronic models like these. It'll be available later this spring, and it'll sell for about $200. A little much, but it includes interfaces to the Apple II and Commodore 64. These tiny robot arms are not toys, but incredibly sophisticated teaching robots that come from the Toki Company of Tokyo. They use a material called shaped memory alloy for power. Since no motors are involved, these gentle robots are staggeringly realistic. And for their use of extremely advanced technology, they receive Best of Show, Foreign Division. The most innovative product at CES was also the most puzzling, presenting the space tablet from Sonature. This thing is like a light pen, except that it also measures the distance the pen is being held from the screen. It works with ultrasonic distance detectors and a stylus that chirps if you listen closely to it. A great idea, but what can you do with it? I gave it my annual Hammer Looking for a Nail Award. Finally, there was the downright stupid stuff. I looked for last year's winner, the electronic alarm that you stuffed into a baby's diaper. It played Singing in the Rain when the baby wet, but I guess that one never took off. I considered an electronic insect repellent someone was selling on the floor for $3 a shot. But who knows, maybe the thing actually works. I'll tell you that next summer. But I finally selected the shower telephone, which, by the way, beat out a jacuzzi phone and a floating bathtub phone for the honors. As the valued prize, all of this year's winners get to split the sack of busted corn chips I found in the bottom of my tote bag when I got home. For the losers, there's always next time. CES happens twice a year, and until the next round of judging, this is Tim Onosco.
Tim's look at the winter CES brings home the point that all that glitters is not gold. There are thousands of products in the consumer electronics marketplace vying for our attention. We have to decide which ones are worth our time and money. From Tim's review of the winter CES to the clampdown on Apple clones, with CBS software, the meeting channel, and computerized poems in between, this week's program has been another look at the people and technology that are changing our lives. Next week, we'll be back with more. For the New Tech Times staff, I'm Mort Krim. Thanks for watching.